Thank you, Norman, and Lucy Fisher and the colleagues present here, the students and others. And it is, I thank you for giving me opportunity to talk on my work in Bihar, India. And see, I belong to an organization called Preservation and Proliferation of Rural Sources and Nature. No, we have not to destroy nature for future generations. And this SRI system of rice intensification and system of wheat intensification, when it got piloted in 2007, it got scaled up to around 2 million farmers in Bihar. You see the conditions of farmers there. There is high rates of food insecurity. No, people do not have food. They have only food for 3 to 6 months. No, and the rest they are forced to migrate and something like that. And Bihar is hub of India's small and marginal farmers. 93% of the farmers are small and marginal farmers. And there is very low productivity of major food grain crops. No, the rice and the wheat, which is major staple food grains. Only 1.6 tons in case of rice and only 2 tons in case of wheat. And agriculture is dominated by rain-fed production systems, and also it is a victim of floods. No? So there is uncertainty in all kinds, and poor access to production resources, very low irrigation availability, and lack of access to electricity, high cost of diesel. So these are all very constraints there. Poor and ineffective market infrastructure, weak agriculture supply chains, and lack of agro-processing post-harvest technology. Poor and ineffective. I mean to say that Bihar is one of the poorest state of India, and people, we have very large population there. And the macro situation, if you see of the national scenario, the natural resources are declining. No, after the Green Revolution, 30 years hence the Green Revolution, natural resources are declining. Rural livelihoods under threat and rural life at stake. There is poor penetration of Green Revolution. Green Revolution technologies which came in, that has poor penetration around urban centers, nearby villages. Yet the existing situation is confronting diminishing returns. Now scientists are finding that it is giving diminishing returns. Thus, there is urgent need for pro-poor agroecological innovations, for pro-poor across the globe and across India. Existing prevailing technology is unsustainable as it is targeted at the crop life above the ground. What we have been focusing since Green Revolution and before that also, we have focused much of our research and development above the ground. And mainstream research and development ignores the precious aspects of below ground activities. No, that is what we call root system and microbial life, the soil systems, the soil biology. It has been neglected since. So, addressing food security through appropriate technologies, which locally we are calling, people call this a system of root intensification, because it has impacted various crops there. No. So, to keep the same language and term, people are using this. And root is the mouth of the plant. Let us keep it healthy and well functioning. No? Though it is not seen from eyes, they are below the ground, but they are the major mouth of the plant. The SRI method considers root plays crucial role. No? This is different from the Green Revolution thinking. So, if you see this SRI revolution, which I learned from Norman Hoff, and it has three major, if you see the assumptions behind this revolution, it uses low external inputs. The poor farmers have very limited reach to resources, no? Very limited purchasing capacity. So this is accessible to the resource poor families, and this leads to cost effective crop economy. Household food security, it has high productivity to ensure enhanced availability of homegrown food grains to a small and marginal farmers. With a small piece of land, they can get food security for whole the year. And SR is an inclusive system and ensures sustainability. It means conserving precious soil, water and environment carrying capacity for the future generations. No, it is not declining. So these are the basic assumptions behind. You see the roots, how that is different when we grow through this SRI method. the understanding of the principles, if you see, look into we prime seeds and the planting material for any crops, and we use these young age seedlings or sprouted seeds, and we give this wider spacing which is required for them. Single or few seedlings or seeds is done there. Use of integrated nutrient management, organic natural fertilizers, these are enhancing the soil biome, and no standing water in the field, just keep soil moist. Intercultivate with weeders to aerate soil and improve root health, intercultivation for soil aeration. Surface sowing and surface transplanting, do not go much inside, providing a space for roots to grow close to its potential. We do not give a space for roots to grow to close to its potential. Nutritional and microbial security to rhizosphere, the root system. And multiple relationships of human with trees and plants. We respect human, but we do not respect the plants. When we start respecting plant, plant will start respecting us. This is transfer of innovation to improve its spread among poor. You see, the major component of the green revolution has been based on this gene and input centric, but this innovation is more knowledge incentive and less input incentive. It means if you transfer knowledge only, it can bring changes in poor man's life. Knowledge has to be delivered to be bypassed people who matter most to us, any small and marginal farmers who are not mainstream, who do not have access to the main resources. Proper institutional architecture is required to be developed. And informal institutions can lead to extension of knowledge, like NGOs, civil societies. But formal agencies needed for a strength and policy framework for wider outreach. At universities, the government should come forward to help this scale up, I mean understand the things. You see, the strategy we use in our project is awareness generating among the deprived communities, the poor communities, scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, backward communities. We use audio visual aids, SRI films, materials and flakes and plasticides materials, manuals as easy understandable tools, using older experienced SRI farmers to campaign in villages. Those who have experienced SRI, they go to teach other farmers or other villagers or other officials, other district fellows. Regular village meetings for awareness, motivation and adoption in continuum, this goes on. And collaborating with government extension and research programs. No, all research stations in India, they are collaborating with us. Indian Agriculture Research Institute, Indian Council of Agricultural Research, Agriculture Technology Management Agency under Government of Bihar, Krishi Vigyan Kendra, this comes under State Agriculture University, and other research institutions. A stakeholders workshop we organize at block level, district level, state level, also at universities level, agriculture universities level, others. And we participate in various events organized by government. The approaches we follow, pro-poor incentives to village resource persons. This is village resource persons based extension methodology. It has been also selected among the best scaling up strategies by the World Bank. Pro-women incentives to staffs and VRPs. Facilitating women's common interest group. We work with women interest group. Women are at the forefront. This is credit to be given and not to be taken, the strategies. Collective ownership of success and failures. Non-negotiable principles. We maintain integrity at all levels. 75% time is invested on motivational training and 25% on technical aspects of this SRI. This is Panch Sa and Panch Ja. Actually, this is our Pran's core basic principles of development. This is Satya, Samaya, Seva, Sanskar and Samanta. And Panch Ja is for the land, water, animals, human beings, forests. No, how do we integrate this so that the future generation is safe? These are the persons at the age point. These are the village women who are trained in this technology, and they promote. They work with 50 to 70 farmers, each of them. They sit weekly for review and planning. And there is a continuous engagement. Around 500 to 700 such village resource persons are associated with me. Yeah, this is yellow color is of SRI. No, they take out a rally, a movement in village, in local urban areas, This is on Republic Day, they take out a big procession displaying all the innovations done by that, and government accepts that as a very positive tool. You see the impact which has been studied at various occasions. Before the implementation, most of the families had only food for 3 to 6 months. No, but after this implementation, now they are getting food for round the year. No, this is great change in the villages where it has been piloted. Earlier dependent on Mahajans for credit in hours of need. No, the poor farmers were dependent on the local Mahajans, local creditors. Those who are participating SRI, method of crop cultivation in cereals, vegetables, are getting cash income apart from food grain security. The indiscriminate use of pesticides and chemical fertilizers. Earlier they were using indiscriminate, like increasing fertilizers and pesticides, chemical fertilizers. Now in the villages we are working, there is reduced use of chemical fertilizers and pesticides substituted by organic natural. Usually poor farmers, particularly Mahadalits, Mahadalits are called the poorest of the poor in Bihar. No? Among Dalit also, the poorest community who do not have sufficient food to run their family. No? And they were forced to migrate after 3 to 6 months of agricultural seasons to other places just to get the survival grains. Now they are getting substantially, the migration has been reduced in remote villages and they are getting dignified livelihoods there. Farmers used 40 kg of paddy seeds per acre, 54 to 81 kg of wheat seeds per acre and 7 to 8 kg of aisle seeds per acre. But now they are using 2 kg of paddy seeds per acre, 10 kg of wheat seeds per acre and 250 gram per kg of aisle seeds per acre. You see, this is reduced and now this technology is accessible to the poor farmer because of the low inputs. Food, the Mahadalit commonly took only alternate meals. Now they are taking regular meals. If you see this, again dependence, farmers were highly dependent on markets for fertilizers. But now they are making themselves local fertilizers and local pesticides. This great impact on gender, no? Women in villages were reluctant to speak to the outsiders, but now they have come out and they are going to different districts, different states to train officials, to train various scientists. No? Earlier they were getting not getting quality grains, but now they are getting healthy grains to eat. Mainstreaming of SRI, scientific institutions were hesitant to accept this. No? A lot of opposition from the mainstream scientific institutions in India. No? IARI, Indian Council of Agricultural Research, they were opposing this. But after this establishment, now Indian Council of Agricultural Research, Indian Agricultural Research Institute and other research institutions are coming forward to learn this. Impact on state production. Before introduction of SRI method, you see there was only 4 million tons in a year previously. But after its introduction, government of Bihar took it up. Now the production every year is more than 8 million tons of paddy there. If we include this at the national level, in some area, there are huge, savings of inputs, at the same time, enhanced production to feed the people, and at national level, the food security will be more to the poor and marginal farmers. You see the various crops. Those farmers who are having this cultivation in paddy and wheat, they are getting food security for entire year. Those who are practicing SRI principles in other crops like rapeseed, mustard, vegetables, aisle seeds, they are getting cash surplus to run the households also apart from food security. So these are the various crops you see. This is sugarcane, this is elephant foot yam, and these are brinjal. And so people are growing various crops using this SRI principles, their system of crop intensification, system of root intensification. You see, this is the perception of farmers who use this, no? When they are doing this, using this principles in paddy, they are getting 100% enhancement in yield. Where they are using in wheat, they are getting 50% enhancement. Where they are using these principles in green gram, they are getting 50% enhancement in yield. In SRI, tomato 55%, chili 22%, brinjal 45%, elephant foot yam 80%, sugarcane also 85%. You see huge enhancement in rapeseed yield by 150%. You see, these are all perception of the farmers who are practicing this. These are various crops, you see. This is one thing from single grain, how the crop is growing, number of branches is coming up. You see the bunch of silicua in oil seed, in rape seed, from a single seed, no, from single seedling of that seed, how that is coming. So the, again, you see the 64 panicles from two seeds of wheat, no, under this wheat intensification. So huge, we also working, we asked initially local research institutions to support us in developing implements. They did not support it. So we started developing. We conducted workshops for local blacksmiths there and gave our design. They developed the SRI implements with our support. And these implements are widely accepted, not only in Bihar, in India, across 13 states in India, they have been demanding, government of Madhya Pradesh is demanding from those blacksmiths in Bihar. And we are also working since 5 to 6 years on this wheat seed drill for system of wheat intensification. Last year it got finalized and we are very much satisfied to use this. This year government of Bihar and government of India, both they will be taking to scale it up in the whole of the nation. Fertilizer made by us and also practiced, this is doing very good. Biopesticides and locally manufactured sugarcane eye extractor for SSI, Sugarcane Sustainable Initiative, or you can say SRI, sugarcane. This is the research we organize. You see, some of the plots are in our field. You are seeing, this is from IRI plot. We also helped them in organizing experiments at their research stations. One farmer from our project got shifted to Indian Agriculture Research Institute and he organized that and they got very good yield and now they are satisfied, no? So you see how growth in our project took place even after I work in a very drought area district, no? So even after the strained conditions, number of farmers participated in that and that is doing very well. You see the vegetables, when compared the local production and the when applied with SRI, what is the difference it is bringing in the yield of the farmers. The local small this vermicompost units, this is also being scaled up by government of Bihar and being taken up by the government of India also, recently they will be taken up. You see, this is the vegetables they are practicing in the villages. Earlier they were no cultivators, no? They are not traditional cultivators, they are the poor families. Now they have shifted to SRI cultivation and practicing number of crops with principles and having dignified livelihoods. See, the government of Bihar also accepted this in a strained condition, in dry conditions, how do we manage this? So this is central nursery. A big nursery is made for paddy and from there seedlings are taken for transplanting by different farmers in the local area, no? So this is government program and they are collaborating with us in raising these nurseries. You see in other crops also, it is how it is growing in various crops, wheat, rapeseed and vegetables. How this one plant from SRI rapeseed, you see. One farmer got award from Honorable President of India, SRI farmers, women, men. One of the farmer got award from the Minister of Agriculture, Government of India for promoting this SRI in various crops. One small boy got award of rupees 50,000 from Sri Narendra Modi, who is presently the Prime Minister of India. Last year he gave this award before becoming Prime Minister. PRAN project identified as one among the best projects in the country by a jury for the National Scotch Excellence Award 2014. Still, I will be given this award on 19th and 20th in India at New Delhi. You see, this is the Chief Minister who released the SRI manual on this oil seed, SCI manual, no? And he has become now Chief Minister of Bihar and he will be meeting with me to scale it up in various crops. This is at the national level, you see, National Food Security Mission under Government of India, they have invested 100 crores of rupees. National Rural Livelihood Mission, it is a very big project under Government of India. They are scaling it up across all the states of the country. No, very big project, 36,600 crores of rupees its project is National Rural Livelihood Promotion Society, National Rural Livelihood Mission. SDTT, it is a donor agency which is giving a big support to promote SRI in various states of the country.
Can you say the name for SDTT?
Sir Dorabji Tata Trust. No, Sir Dorabji Tata Trust is a donor agency which is a greater, big donor agency of India, which promotes SRI across various states in India, including Bihar. My present project is sponsored by this SDTT program in Bihar. NABARD also invested, and they invested 50 crores of rupees in Jharkhand and demonstrated this. You see, this is National Consortium of SRI. One National Consortium of SRI is created at Delhi level. Norman is associated there, and this is headed by Dr. B.C. Bara, and various agencies are partners to that. We are also partner to that National Consortium of SRI. Tripura government, Bihar government, Madhya Pradesh government, government of Odisha, Tamil Nadu government, government of Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh government, Assam government, these are several states of India. They are active in taking it up for its common people. SRI secretariat at Live Whole Link Foundation. This is again hosted by Sir Dorabji Tata Trust Mumbai, and they have formed a secretariat of SRI to promote across India. Many civil society organizations are associated with National Consortium of SRI, and also SRI secretariat at Live Whole Link Foundation Bhuvaneswar in Odisha. Various research stations, Indian Council of Agricultural Research and Indian Agricultural Research Institute at New Delhi, state agricultural universities, they are taking it up, and farmers are the greater stakeholders. You see, this is the model we are advocating to Government of India. If a farmer has only 0.5 acres of land, how can he achieve the food security as well as well-being in a dignified manner? He can go for 0.4 acres paddy, 0.3 acres in wheat, 0.2 acres in rapeseed, 0.3 acres in SRI vegetables at various times, Kharif, Rabi and summer seasons, and can get easily 52,120 rupees additional income to run the household in a dignified manner. This is SRI is a pro-poor agroecological innovation for household food security, which increased production in cost-effective manner. So if we have to remove poverty from the globe, we need to integrate this methodology among poor community of the different countries. Enhanced food security and income to millions of small and marginal farmers in India. And farmers are having dignified livelihoods and are happy with this. Capacity strengthened to combat climate resilience in agriculture. We are listening more about this global warming effect of that. So SRI has capacity to combat the this climate variations. Being resource conserving agriculture practice, this approach ensures sustainability of natural resources for future generation. We have to keep the natural resources intact for future generations, which has degraded. So this is the only technology which is resource conservation technology, pro-poor technology, which can conserve our natural resources for future generations. And healthy environment is provided for better human life. Everywhere you will see in India, in every household there is disease. Either somebody is from sugar, somebody is from heart attack, somebody is from BP. So if we start this SRI all over, it will give a good human life. Thank you all. This is
lots of time for questions. Why don't you just call on people that are.
Yeah, if you have any question, you can ask me or clarifications, anything.
I can see that education and knowledge and training constitute a very large part of this effort. To what extent, if at all, are social media used by this kind of a program?
You see, social media, you can say, there is one SRI at Cornell itself, which is there, but there, what is used? We used three things. As extension methodology at the local level, we brought the people from the research station to the ground level, to the community people, to media people, to talk to the farmers who are practicing this SRI. No? And when they started sharing their experiences, the officials of the government, they took it at the higher level. The research scientists took it at their own stations. No? And there how it got spread in India gradually.
That means that in Bihar, the social media, Facebook, Twitter, and those are really not reaching the village level yet. Is that right? Maybe
yeah.
Among the NGO communities and researchers, but it's not percolating down?
Yeah.
Yeah. Let me ask a related question.
Yeah.
To what extent, at the farmer level, have mobile phones penetrated? I have some data that suggests that mobile phones are very, very important in Indian agriculture. To what extent are they a factor, if at all, in your program?
Yeah, in my program, biofarms were saying.
Mobile phone.
Cell phones.
Cell phones.
Mobiles.
Yeah, mobiles.
Cell phones.
No, you see, most of the farmers in villages now have mobiles, no? And they are connected with our offices. Although we have one village resource persons in every village, no? Which I showed you during our presentation, that the one of the practicing farmer is trained in 3 to 4 phases, and then he starts hand holding the other new farmers to spread SRI, and this way it is spreading among farmers to farmers, no? So we are very limited staff there, but we train people, the farmers, how to take this to another farmer, and they take it, the practitioners farmers are taking this to other farmers itself. And phones are effective. Now we are piloting this year the ComCare also under this ComCare concept of this mobile system.
What is that concept?
ComCare is software, no?
Ah.
Where VRP, when he is not able to meet the subject matter specialist there in the village, he or she can send directly the problems. No, and we can from the office itself give solution to them. So this is ComCare, which is being piloted this year. Yes. Yeah.
Could you tell me a bit more about how you reduced fertilizer inputs? What substitutions or what? How did you spread out fertilizer to reduce the inputs?
Fertilizers inputs. Initially, when I piloted this, I used these chemical fertilizers. No. But with chemical fertilizers, we used very much this vermicompost also. But gradually, we are shifting towards this organic fertilizers and natural fertilizers. They are made from the local materials, cow dung, cow urine, jaggery, pulse floor, no, the goat bits, the poultry bits, and these are being analyzed by research stations. What is the content of NPK, what is the content of micronutrients, no? And we are promoting this among the villagers. So now farmers are coming forward to adopt these fertilizers, as fertilizers have become quite costly there. Yes.
I'm interested in the various categories or metrics that you use to kind of evaluate the fact that the scaling up is really working. And I'm curious about how you actually developed those data. Did someone come in and do a study at a certain point of time, or did you develop them by monitoring over time, or some combination of that? And I'm also interested in the cost effectiveness of getting the data to be able to tell the story, because I think that's a really important piece of scaling up, is being able to tell a story like that.
Yeah. When it was piloted in Bihar in 2007, no, in 2008-09, Sir Dodabi Data Trust, they commissioned a study externally. They evaluated it very much, and based on that study, they invested around ₹100 crores to spread this. Apart from that, it was a part of the government of Bihar project, I was piloting, and World Bank set up various evaluation team to evaluate its impact in the ground and what it is bringing about. And thereafter, the state government of Bihar also set up a delegation team, government of Bihar, with technical persons, with scientific persons from research stations, and they asked us to give the data of the villages. I gave them raw villages. They selected based on some statistical analysis, and the team for 15 days went to the villages on their own. They evaluated that, and thereafter the chief minister talked to me and the agriculture minister talked to me, and they included this in their own program. And the current program which we are implementing, we have very standard MIS system for that. We have very rigorous data keeping at our offices, and that can be made accessible to anybody.
Much of this extension, you talk about this, has been done under IDA funding. It's a anti-poverty rural livelihoods program. And so the World Bank has brought in outside groups. Is Paul here? I didn't look around. Paul's back. Paul, why don't you say something about the evaluation that you were involved with?
So it's on hold. So we have one planned, but because of changes in leadership in the organization that organizes the self-help groups, they've postponed it. So there was sort of a previous one before I got involved. That was a more informal thing. We were proposing to do a randomized control trial, cluster randomized control trial of the extension. But hopefully it'll go forward next year, but currently postponed.
So following on that point, my curiosity was regarding women's role, because if they were passive for the, they work in agriculture, but they were not very voice their concerns. And this program appears that incorporate them very nicely. You mentioned that you work with self-help groups, but can you expand a little bit? Who through whom? Was a local leader? Was a woman leader? What happened? What is the process to make these women part of the program?
You see, World Bank was implementing one project in Bihar that is called Bihar Rural Livelihood Promotion Society. No? That project was being implemented by Government of Bihar. And Government of Bihar, under their setup, they promote SSG, Women Self-Help Group. No? And they invited us to pilot this method with the women SSGs being promoted by Bihar Rural Livelihood Promotion Society. So if you go to the website of Bihar Rural Livelihood Promotion Society, you will get many of the data and many of the events being taken up. Also on the website of Government of Bihar, you can find various studies conducted there. So those women, and we directly got associated with these women, the SSGs being promoted by them, and we brought them into we demonstrated with the women itself in villages, and they become leaders gradually, and they started helping other farmers also. And not only that, Government of Bihar used these skilled farmers to train their officials across all 38 districts of Bihar. And also these women were called by Government of Madhya Pradesh, Government of Odisha, and by various agencies working in different parts of the country. So the farmer, a skilled farmer, was also called by IRI to assist the scientist in doing the experiment there. So lot of more than 70-80 farmers, they have been recruited by various organizations in the country to promote SRI in their area. No? So this is how things are going on, and this is women led in the local area.
So just a bit of background, the Andhra Pradesh government about 15 years ago started self-help groups as a methodology for rural development, and it sort of took off there. The World Bank picked up that idea for Bihar. The government civil servant who headed the work in Andhra Pradesh is now heading a big program for the National Rural Livelihood Mission in Delhi. So the self-help groups, SHGs, have become kind of a methodology for local mobilization. And it's for primarily the marginal land. When Marguerite, my wife and I, visited Bihar 3 years ago with Erica Steiger, where we visited self-help groups in Gaya State and in Muzaffarpur district of the state.
And, you know, we would meet with them for a couple hours at a time, and they would explain their circumstances. What was really interesting was that these were often untouchable. Women would not have spoken in public. They had a few years before. Now they have, you know, consumer buying clubs, so they buy flour and salt in bulk and sell themselves at about half the price. Otherwise, they have monitoring committees, so all the children of these members are in school, especially the girls. They told us that they've now gone from 2 to 3 months of food security to 6 or 7, now up to 12. Migration has been stopping. But the point is that women themselves have become a very vocal voice. We met with about 300 of them, and you know, they were all very bustling, proud. One of their number has been elected to the state legislative assembly, a woman from the Musahari subcaste, which is about the lowest of the low. And she's become really a spokesperson and symbol for the untouchable women in Bihar. She's been selected by the government of India to go to Bangkok next month for the World Food Day program on women farmers. So she'll be representing all the women farmers in India. And here she comes from the Musahari rat-eating, rat-catching caste. And she's now an MLA, very well-known and very prominent. So the leadership mobilization, which Anil has referred to, is one of the most interesting things. That with this boost in productivity, now the husbands don't have to migrate out, they send the kids to school, they have more disposable income. And so there's kind of a social economy, which I wish, you know, people at Cornell and elsewhere would study in detail. The productivity and the economic side is interesting, but maybe the social side is also a bit more interesting.
Yes, sir.
My area is rice, and my question is, in order to achieve success, you have to have control of water, and like a low-lift pump. But many farmers simply have to rely on surface irrigation, and the water may come or may not come. It seems to me that's rather critical in terms of whether you can adopt these practices or not.
You see, where I am working, there is also a drought area, no? And water occasionally comes. Rainfall is very low, no? That is the extreme dry area of Bihar, where I am working. And if there is moisture in the soil, no? If there is no water to transplant, even people are taking under direct seeding, but applying the principles of SRI, no? Running the weeders gradually. With moisture you can run the weeders. We have developed weeders which can run in that condition also. So in various conditions, you if you have water, irrigated area if you have, so there you go for transplanting. If you do not have irrigated area, there is uplands, no? You can go for direct seeding of rice applying these principles.
So a lot of this is rain fed. Necessity.
Rain fed is no problem. I'm talking about surface irrigation.
There's not a lot of.
Yes, surface irrigation is not there, and people are depending only on the natural rainfall which comes in. That is completely rain fed area. But even if there is surface irrigation available, there people are growing these using these principles.
Anil, I'm curious about your experiences with a wide range of crops.
Yes.
They're all positive. So if I were to ask you, what is it about this way of growing crops that actually makes the difference? Can you,
yeah.
From what you've seen, what you've observed, what is it about, what are the important changes?
So I explained one understanding about the basic principles, no?
Yeah, but I don't care about the basic principles.
What is it?
What I'm caring about is, what are you seeing? Hmm. I mean, you know, I would go back to that last photograph you had. Those are really healthy plants.
Okay.
There's no disease, there's no pests.
Not of organic fertilizer.
Yeah.
But you don't have enough organic fertilizer for the whole country. I mean, you can't do organic fertilizer in
every
field. Mm. So, you know, there's got to be something else about this which
When I started there, no, I was investing rupees 10 lakh on pesticides applications, no? But now, even I am not investing rupees 10,000. So as we move forward, no, the crops are very healthy. And when you are healthy, diseases and pests also attack very less. No? So that happens in crops also. When we started in 2007, we invested a lot of money on these pesticides and other things. But gradually, when patches after patches started getting converted into SRI, the consumption of pesticides got reduced. And then we started integrating with the local fertilizer and pesticides. So that has helped. The farmers understand that giving, you see, all the principles need to be taught to the farmers, basically. And when the farmer sees himself or herself that she is getting more yield per crop or per unit area, they start enhancing their area, they start teaching to others, they start talking to others. But the regular engagement of these village resource persons, village resource person stays in the village itself. He is from a farming community, he has been a farmer, no? So the knowledge the villagers are getting is from the village resource person. And those resource persons they are also the practitioners, SRI practitioners, as well as they have been trained in a phased manner to help other farmers.
Can you talk about the pits that farmers dig for the root growth?
Yes.
That you didn't say much about.
Actually, for any crop, I told in that presentation that we create peat, no? When you create peat, you enhance the bulk density, no? Around the rhizosphere. How will you enhance the bulk density? By adding the organic matter to that, no? By adding the natural fertilizer to that. And then the penetrating power of roots and rootlets get enhanced. You get more volume of roots. You get more dry weight of roots. And when there is more dry weights, there is more uptake, more microbial population because of the organic matter. So microbial population and roots, they interplay the role entirely. And they supply that to the shoots, and the shoots becomes like this, if you see in rice plants. So when it grows like this, there is more interception of solar light per unit area. No, photosynthesis is more, and there is more production. So this is very scientific kind of thing.
When Eric and I visited,
I would just say that we've done a lot of work growing crops on beds with furrow irrigation. And it's sort of like SRI that you have far fewer plants always. And the net result of that is, of course, that you get healthy plants, you get good air movement through fields, and farmers immediately comment, we don't have any pest and disease problems.
Right.
And, you know, when we first started, we said, oh, come on, you know. But then actually when you get looking, and of course the farmers are right. I mean, you know, So I think a lot of this is exactly what you say. You get a healthy plant, and then that, you know, you still may be in an environment that has limitations, but you do way, way better than you were in your prior condition.
We saw mustard plants as big as I am, or as big as Erica was. They start from that tiniest of seeds, but they make a pit, maybe a foot wide, deep, fill it with loose soil, organic matter, and those plants, little tiny seeds, and the seedling in its span about 18 inches apart becomes 6 feet tall. And it has more pods, heavier grain weight. It's a function of the roots and then the soil, soil organisms that are giving various services to the plants. And that works then across plant species. So green gram, black gram, red gram, lentils, soybeans, kidney beans, etc. All of them benefit from room for the roots to grow in, you know, Indian soils. It's like kind of, how can the roots of a lentil plant, you know, penetrate this? But if you give a head start, and it takes labor. And these people, you know, they have labor compared to capital. they invested in making these growing pits, they call them. So you get good root growth and you get more life in the soil. It seems to work across lots and lots of different
areas. Pits is something that is not, I mean, you don't do that for rice and wheat, surely. I do it for vegetables.
No, you, for rice and wheat, we run the weeders, no?
The weeder can aerate the
soil. Yeah, but you know, that weeder that removes weeds, it doesn't really aerate the soil, to be honest. I mean, it may cut roots off, which may ultimately be beneficial, but I mean, from a soil physical perspective, it's not really. If you break
the
crust, yes, but
it's crust. Yeah. We break the crust and aerate the soil, no? When we compare of a normal paddy plant to a SRI paddy plant, you will find that the rhizosphere is white in SRI paddy plant. The volume is more. And under normal paddy plant, normal cultivation, you find there is blackish because they have not been aerated. Soil aeration has not gone there. So, and when soil aeration takes place in the soil, no microbial become active, microbes around that. And that enhances the capacity of this branching and this tillering and these other things, no? So,
maybe it's white because it's aerobic and it's orange, usually not black, but orange when it's reduced soil environment because it's got iron deposited on the roots. So that's typical of wetland plants, you know? So I wouldn't necessarily say that's positive or negative, I would just say it's different soil chemistry.
Yes, soil biology, soil chemistry, everything acts there. And IRI did this for 3 years, for rice and wheat, Indian Agriculture Research Institute. And a group of 7 scientists was assessing this, no? Plant physiologists, soil microbiologists, the entomologist, the agronomist, the agricultural economics. And all after continuously doing this for 3 years, they have come to a conclusion that these principles are very relevant for both the crops, no, for rice and wheat. That is why Government of India is trying to integrate this at a national level. And in October, Minister of Agriculture from Government of India will move to field with National Consortium of SRI to understand this better with the farmers, and that then they will integrate at the national level.
Actually, we probably run out of our announced time, but Anil will stay around if you'd like to talk. Do we have to move out of here, Lucy, or will someone else come in?
I forgot to look, but nobody's waiting out here to throw us out.
If you want to stay around and ask specific questions,
yeah.
Most welcome. And I'd like to thank Anil on behalf of the group.
Thank you.